In 1998, Josh Resnick and Andrew Goldman caught the business bug and left Activision to make their very own company. But they remained on good terms with their old bosses and founded their studio with an equity investment from Activision. So good was the relationship that Activision hired them to make two sequels to games they owned. These were titles that Resnick had worked on, Battlezone and Dark Reign. And while neither game sold particularly well, the fledgling company had proven that they could successfully take a pre-existing franchise and make a game on time and on budget. As the years went by, these talents would attract some of the very biggest names in entertainment. But even after they had made it to AAA status as a developer, Pandemic was to learn the hard way that those who climb the highest have the farthest way to fall. After finishing their Activision games, cleverly titled Battlezone 2 and Dark Reign 2, several other franchise owners took notice. 3DO came to them to reinvigorate their flagging Army Men franchise, which resulted in 2002's Army Men RTS, which was an RTS with Army Men. It was developed by the Los Angeles-based company's second studio in Brisbane, Australia. The guys had enough confidence in themselves to fund teams in separate continents. The game was praised as by far the best in the series, but sadly didn't sell well enough to keep the struggling 3DO from filing for bankruptcy. But at the same time, Pandemic signed a deal with a far more financially stable partner, the United States Army. The Army wanted to see if they could use video games to help train young recruits who had grown up playing video games in the basics of unit tactics. And while they were working on that project, they set off to make another game in another major franchise. Star Wars. The Clone Wars was a vehicle shooter that began where the film Episode II ended and carried on through the rest of the war. While not considered one of the greatest Star Wars games in future years, LucasArts was impressed enough to ask them to make another, larger Star Wars game, and this time, they wouldn't have to release it alongside a film. And so in 2004, Pandemic released both Full Spectrum Warrior and Star Wars Battlefront.
Oh, knee point fight.
Yes.
Oh. That hurt?
That's a kill.
Alongside the version meant for the military, Pandemic was allowed to produce a modified commercial version of Full Spectrum to recoup the cost of the production. It was unsurprisingly one of the most realistic military simulators ever to hit the mainstream market. A real-time tactics game, it put the players in command of two fire teams engaged in a fictional conflict. For the commercial release, the game had an added story and fully developed characters, but players could input a code and unlock the full military version for even better accuracy. It was considered one of the first strategy games to successfully use a console's control scheme, and ended up being a big seller for Pandemic. But nowhere near as big as Battlefront. Essentially a Star Wars version of the popular Battlefield series, Battlefront let players play as soldiers from either side of the famous conflict, and battle it out online, on foot, or in vehicles. Despite a relatively weak single player, its addicting multiplayer and wish-fulfilling premise rocketed the game to the top of the charts. In LucasArts' long history, Battlefront became its fastest and best-selling title to date. Pandemic had hit the big time. So much so that in 2005, they released not one, not two, but three games. Battlefront 2 was an obvious choice for the company, and like its predecessor, sold big numbers, attracting fans with the addition of starships and Jedi. Meanwhile, Pandemic successfully leveraged their influence at LucasArts and got them to publish a game that had nothing to do with the Force. Mercenaries: Playground of Destruction. Yeah. Mercenaries was an open-world game that let players do whatever they wanted, with a plethora of side quests and missions to choose from. They could lend their aid to any of various factions in a fictionalized North Korea. One of its major selling points was the ability to destroy anything in the game, including faction headquarters. Finally, the Brisbane crew released their next game, the Ode to Sci-Fi Camp, Destroy All Humans.
The procedure will be protracted and invasive.
Putting the player in control of an alien sent to Earth to harvest human brains, the title was the brainchild of Matt Harding. But because he didn't want to spend 2 years of his life writing about killing people, he instead left the company to go travel and became famous for his "Where the Hell is Matt?" videos. On top of all this, 2005 also saw a pandemic merge with RPG powerhouse BioWare. The companies believed that their pooled resources would allow them to do more than they could alone, even though each company would retain its own identity and operate independently. As if one merger wasn't enough, after the release of sequels to Full Spectrum Warrior and Destroy All Humans, in 2006, the joint Pandemic BioWare venture was bought outright by Electronic Arts. As the top game publisher in the world, Pandemic figured they had hit true financial security and would now be able to do whatever they wanted. That wasn't how it played out. While the LA team got to work on a sequel to Mercenaries, the Brisbane crew was told by EA to make a Batman game. The crew got to work and came up with some great ideas for an original linear adventure, only to be told after production had begun that it had to be an open-world game based on the upcoming film, The Dark Knight. Forced to scrap all the work they'd done, they rushed to complete a functioning product in a tight window and couldn't do it in time, even for the DVD release. As such, with their profits falling short of expectations, EA closed down the Brisbane studio. But after their successful Star Wars titles, Pandemic LA got to do a similar game for another major franchise. The Lord of the Rings Conquest released in early 2009, letting gamers step into the shoes of both soldiers and heroes of the War of the Ring. But despite Pandemic's reputation and the popularity of the franchise, the game was panned as being buggy and poorly designed, possibly because the game was rushed out the door by their new overlords, EA. The great buyout was starting to look like a bad move. Still, Pandemic was working on a brand new IP, The Saboteur, set in Nazi-occupied France. The company had high expectations for the title and hoped it would turn the recent slate of bad news around. But EA wasn't convinced. After posting a net loss of $391 million in the second quarter of 2009, they knew they had to tremendously cut back their staff. And on November 17, 2009, EA broke the news. They were going to shut down Pandemic Studios. A few core personnel were allowed to stay on and finish The Saboteur, and EA has retained the name and brand of the company. But while a studio called Pandemic might rise again, the creative team that made it what it was is now gone.
There are no words for the pain this war has caused.
We won't get another chance to break out.
Spirit is also a casualty during war.
There is no turning back now.
May he find peace in the next world.
Here's to you, brother.
After working for some of the biggest names in entertainment and the military, they couldn't survive their own bosses. But for 11 years, two guys who wanted to set out on their own got to play with Darth Vader, mercenaries, and the entire US Army. No other developer can say the same.